three lanes of traffic in front of several cars that honked at me and screeched and all, and fuck, got to a safe place. I just talked to my brother on the phone a little bit earlier, and he had said, don't use your phone in the car, it's not safe. So I almost killed myself and 12 other people to get to a safe place. So I called 911, and they said, oh yeah, we've had the report on that before. And I sat there and I said, when will I stop this? And so today, before all of you, this is my license to run the universe, and I give it up. I'm not going to run the universe anymore. I do little things kind of cheap on that. Like I'll go to a fast food place or a Taco Bell, and you can spot them right away because there's a mom and she's got two kids one age and two kids another age, right? In other words, she's got her own child and the child's friend, and then another one of her children and a friend. She says, I'll take the four of you to Taco Bell, bad idea. Because they can't do it. You know, she's sitting there trying to hold it together, and they're, this is the most, I could do this.
I can do that better?
And you know, they go over and they get their drink and they fill it too full. And they come over like this with both hands, and they're dribbling all the way. And she says, oh, please, well, leave it alone, honey, because, you know, yes, take your napkin and drink. Oh, and she's trying really hard to keep it together, be a good mom, and to smile, and the kids are starting to, she says, no, please don't run around. Now, the other moms, they just have their own kid, and their own kid comes over, and she says, if you do that again, I'll slap you so hard you'll go home by yourself. From the slap. But the mom who's trying to keep it together, I'll wait and I'll go over to her at just the right moment and I'll say, it is so nice to see how well behaved your children are. And she'll say, oh, are they? There's nothing in it for me because only married mothers do those things. Anyway. I've been suffering from depression for quite a while, and a lot of you might think that you're depressed. I see on television, like, what's the one with the women who get together for lunch and talk about their vaginas?
Sex in the City?
Sex in the City, yeah. They'll be eating out of ice cream containers. And that's, you're depressed if you eat it straight out of the container and not out of the dish. Well, the other night, I ate 2 pounds of strawberries. That's how depressed I was. And you're all eating, so I won't go on. I mean, strawberries are very high in fiber. But we'll leave it right there. When I took a look at the audience, I thought I probably should do some of my prostate material.
Oh, thank you.
Because prostate is a virgin word in comedy. All you have to do is say the word prostate and any other words, and you all of a sudden have a joke. Oh, I took my prostate and we got some strawberries, so 2 pounds of strawberries. Or just how big is your prostate anyway? You know, just anything with the word prostate in it. Well, fellas, want me to leave it at that? Okay, we'll stop right there. But the problem I have is that I am naturally funny, but I'm way, way too good looking to be a comedian. Comedians are usually funny looking, so I arranged to have this bald spot. And I wear this thing around my ear so that I look lumpy and won't look really like a. Like a tall James Bond. And does it work? Yeah, it works. Anyway, so I went to get a haircut, so that I looked fairly good, and they always ask me, what kind of haircut do you want? And I said, I want one that my daughter will like. And they say, well, what is that? And I said, look, when I see my daughter tomorrow, she's going to say, oh, Daddy, I really like your new haircut. Now, are you going to make my daughter into a liar? Oh, you want that kind of haircut? Yes. She's cutting my hair, and she says, the other day I read in the newspaper, and I perk up because you never know when you're going to get material. I read in the newspaper about this woman, she's out walking her dog, and she says, this elderly woman, she was 60 years old, I'm 63, but... Yeah, this very old woman, she couldn't control it, she's taking her dog, and all of a sudden she feels something pull on the leash, reading her, and it's a coyote has grabbed her dog, her little shih tzu, her little Pomeranian poof, her little dog, her little fluffless, you know, and and of course, since she's so elderly, she can't resist, and she has to let go of it. The coyote gets away with the dog. Later on, they find the dog dead. Very sad. Those of you who are dog lovers, weep a little for the rest of us who want to go on with the rest of the program. And they send out a manhunt for the dog, for the coyote. And I think, actually, a coyote hunt would be more effective. But up in the hills... Up in the hills, the dons of all the coyote clans get together, and they're concerned about this, and they say, we're going to have to exert better control over our young soldiers. If we have violence in the streets, as we did in the old days, we're going to attract too much attention from the wildlife department. And so we want you to say, we're going to stick to the importation of illegal immigrants, drugs, child pornography, and the things that we're good at, but tell the young soldiers to put it an end. You know, she was laughing so hard she told me to stop because she was going to ruin my haircut. Anyway, I have another little dog joke. I went to one. It's one of these brand new gas places where you don't use your credit card. You actually go in. And you give them cash.
Oh my God.
Really, really. You give them cash. And so I had to go and do that, see? And so I gave them cash, I went back out, and I put the thing in to pump the gas. And then while I was waiting for it to fill up, I went back in, and this woman had this little fluffy Pomeranian, lots of opsa popsa thing, those fluffy things. It's really upset. She says, yeah, we took him yesterday to be fixed. And I said, fixed? What was the matter with him? You know, well, we took him to be fixed, and he was so upset they couldn't do it. And I said, oh, that kind of fix. Well, good for you, boy. Yeah. Well, other guys, if they come at you with the scissors, just get upset. That's me. And I thought that was pretty good. And then another woman said to me, don't you shop at Home Depot? I used to work at Home Depot. I think I recognize you from Home Depot. Yes. And so there are two things going on in my mind. One is, she's female, and she's talking to me. These are very novel things that really upset my brain. And so I'm in the trance, I get into the car, and I drive off about 20 feet, and I think, I don't think I took the nozzle. So I do what you're supposed to do. And if you're a good Catholic, you confess, you repent, you do penance, right? I went, I took the nozzle, I took it in, and I say, I confess, I did it. And they said, that'll cost you $134. I said, but I confess, I repented. What is the story here? Well, you just can't be a theologian all the time. So, but after that, I go to the ATM. And I like the ATM a little better because it talks to you. If you leave your card in there, it says, please, get your card, sucker. Get your card. But they take it too far at Home Depot. And that's where Home Depot comes to town. They come all together. They take it too far at Home Depot because you get there and they have this checkout, self-checkout, but they have a voice. How many of you have used the self-checkout where they have that voice? And the voice says, what does it say?
scan next item.
Please put your bags into the bagging area.
Item. You put it in the bagging area, and then it says, please put your bag in. I put it in the bagging area. And since it's a hardware store, you know, it doesn't have to say polite. So if you say, hey, this guy doesn't know how to check out his stuff. Hey, that might come to work. And the voice that they use is a voice that has been guaranteed to be the most irritating voice from your whole lifetime. Maybe it's your ex-wife, maybe it's your mother, maybe it's your Aunt Hilda or your fourth grade teacher, but it's this terrible voice and it's saying, you know, now put your card in over there. Oh, you're so stupid. You never know how to put it. Slide the card. Sign your name. Your name. Your own name on the line. What are you supposed to do?
It puts the lotion in the bathroom.
I'm a geezer. I'm a full fledged geezer, and I'm not going to tell you what my problem is. You can watch the Super Bowl, and they have all of these ads about erectile problems. Well, for me, most of my life, erectile problems were when she would say, what's that thing pushing against my leg? You know, that's what I thought were problems. You know, when you had to carry your books in front of you, that was the out of control part of it. I didn't know at this point you're going to have to carry a little bottle around to be sure that you have no problems. Well, the doctor made me a prescription, and I went to the pharmacy, and all of the young women there are very attractive, very personable. They know me by name. They say, oh, Mr. Sanders, we have some heart pills for you so you won't keel over, and, you know, and they're just really sweet to me. And I go and I get my stiffy fix. So she says to me, Mr. Sanford, would you come over here, and I need to talk to you about something. And so I go over, and she says, you see here it says 4 times a month. Your insurance will only cover 4 times a month. Now, this is a setup begging for a punchline. Oh, so they've got women doctors at the insurance company. Whose idea was that? My ex-wife? It sounds like a marriage to me. And then I think, well, wait a minute. 4 times a month? 4 times a month? Can you guarantee 4 a month? That would be an upgrade for me. Comedy is like sex. You're born, you don't know about it. And then you get little hints. And pretty soon, you hear at night, down the hall, you hear these noises. And it seems to be your parents. And they're doing something, but you don't know what it is. And you ask your mother the next day, what were those noises? And she says, it was sex, it was sex! We were having comedy! don't let your friends tell you that your parents have comedy. No, it was sex. And so pretty soon you're having comedy by yourself in your room, you know. And then you go out on a date, and you get your date laughing so hard that you have to marry her. And then afterwards, you're there, and you're married, and she's saying to you, I don't want to make comedy right now. I only want to make comedy when I feel like making comedy. That's your solution to everything, is to make comedy. Well, it doesn't suit any people. Try wearing pants. You go out, pretty soon you're cheating, you're making comedy in cheap bars with cheap jokes, with cheap friends, and then you get really low and you make blonde jokes. Or send jokes to the Reader's Digest. And you sink even lower and you're going to open microphones and standing up and doing stand-up comedy for people who are also comedians, just waiting their turn. Well, one more story. This one's another two. All of this is true. You can't make up good stuff like this. Anyway, when I was in Seattle, my friend Doug Dorsey was one of those people who always managed to have a 3-day growth of beard. I don't know how he did it. And it kind of looked like Ali Oop, you know? But he was an engineer. And he was super intellectual and super, super dense. He just did not get anything. Well, he helped me move our stuff into our apartment before I married my ex-wife. That sounds funny, doesn't it? She was not my ex-wife when I married her. I didn't know she was going to be my ex-wife. She was actually my fiancé. She was actually my girlfriend, and she was my fiancé, and then she was my wife, okay? But she was my future ex-wife, and he came, and we got an apartment, and it was a romantic idea, and we wouldn't stay there together until we were married. So Doug helped me move all this stuff in, and he noticed, because engineers do this in an inventory, he noticed that the pilot lights didn't work quite right. And he said, oh, this is dangerous. You need to get this fixed. So the morning after our wedding, he was there at 8 o'clock in the morning with his tools to fix our pilot lights. And he stayed, and we fixed it for breakfast. But that's the kind of guy that Doug was. Well, how many of you remember the light bulb jokes? How many therapists does it take to change a light bulb?
One.
But just one, but the light bulb has to want to change. How many hippies does it take to change a light bulb? 13. One to change the light bulb, and 12 to relate to the experience. And there were lots of light bulb jokes. Well, he caught on to one about you have a burned out light bulb and a pregnant woman, and how are they different? You got it? You get it? You get the joke? You get the punchline? You cannot unscrew a pregnant woman? I'm sorry, but I had to tell that to get. Well, Ruth hated that kind of humor. Ruth was a high school student who worked for me, and she was a feminazi before that term was coined. And Ruth's idea of the appropriate penalty for somebody committing a rape was to be castrated. So Doug is trying to tell her the joke. How many pregnant light bulbs does it? No, I mean, if your light bulb, needs to be changed, unscrewed. No, I said, don't tell Ruth this joke. She will not like this joke. Ruth will not appreciate this joke. And he finally stumbles through and tells a joke, and she glares at him. And I say, Doug, how can you be sure that a man cannot impregnate a woman? And he says, I don't know. And I say, you cut off his balls. Ruth falls down on the ground, laughing, roaring, and Doug says,